Hello again, everyone. I hope that today was good for you. It was so gratifying for me to watch all the talks, to watch all the conversation that's happening in Slack, to see all the connections there. It's really been a great day, and I know that tomorrow's going to be just as good. But before we get there, we get to go to this concert. We've got two great sets by some bands that are absolutely stunning. The first one is one of our returning old friends at this point, Deep Sea Diver. And then the second band is Lakou Mizik. They're from Haiti. And before we jump into that, I get to announce the details around our donation this year. If you noticed as you were registering, you had an opportunity to submit or to contribute to a fund for donation and to offer a suggestion of where that money should be donated. And this year we have chosen a group that's called Partners in Health. So typically Progress focuses on STEM education or the health support education or care of children in need. And this year, we're stepping outside of that a little bit because Partners in Health has been able to have such a, that what they do is support healthcare in underserved areas, and they provide a service that is so impactful. And it seems like it's just a great group. They care so much. And together with nearly 100 of our chef friends in the support of Progress, we get to donate $20,000 to that group. And that's not chump change. I'm very excited for that amount of money. And I'm honored and humbled to be part of that group. So congratulations, thanks Partners in Health. And let's get to the concert.
Hello, Chef, and everyone at ChefConf. Thank you so much for having us back. We're like old friends now. We're Deep Sea Diver, and we're going to play you some songs.
That was awesome.
Thank you, Derek.
Thank you for being here. Let me take this.
Absolutely.
Off. Last time you were here, the world was a different place.
Yes, it was.
Let me ask you just a quick question. What were you doing the first time you heard of COVID?
Driving on tour. Okay. I think we were somewhere near California, Southern California, and we kind of heard of the first cases originating in my hometown. So it was like pretty scary.
was it scary, or was it like
it was
more
just
abstract?
Kind of like a weird, ominous cloud around everything. Just like, what is this something? Is this nothing? Like, I mean, never dealt with a pandemic before. We were lucky to be like coming home and not like heading out on tour. Mm-hmm. I had friends that were, you know, eventually got stuck overseas for a little bit, but it was pretty crazy. But yeah, it was daunting.
Did you start getting concerned about it? Like, did it start evolving? Like, hey, this is a thing? Or was it more like waiting for it to be done? Because that was my own personal thing.
So when I first heard about it, I think, you know, we were experiencing just being on the road and, you know, doing the normal things, hugging people at shows, high-fiving. We played the second to last show in Tacoma. And then we went away and played our last one. And by the time we came back to Seattle, the climate had completely changed. And UW had shut down, the university, the streets were empty. It was just like very apocalyptic feeling. And yeah, and it's scary because, I had no idea it was going to, A, last this long, and B, I don't know, cause so much pain in the world, you know?
But you were also in an interesting place where you were working on a new record. So you were kind of transitioning into something new altogether, and then just have to stop for a while. What was that like?
So having COVID hit with basically we had finished our record right before, and then to not know when we were going to get to release it. And it was sort of jarring, but also I felt at peace about it too, because our band has been, I think over the years, really good at pivoting. And so it was almost like, I guess to turn a bad situation into something interesting. There wasn't many other bands releasing in 2020. And so it was like, okay, well, what is the standard? We get to set our own standards and be as creative as possible through live streams or the videos that we make, how we connect with our fans. And so it ended up becoming a somewhat bizarre adventure. In the end, yeah.
The experience that you have with fans has been like this. You're on stage, they watch you, they clap, they buy your merch. Mm-hmm. But now you're having kind of an intimate relationship with your fans because you're live streaming.
Right.
How was that for you?
I think our relationship with our fans did change, and we were able to get in front of new faces because I think there was a correlation between the record, which was more vulnerable, and the way that we were allowing ourselves to go a little bit further, you know, via social media, which was the only way to communicate with people during that time, and let people, quote unquote, into our homes and like have these live streams where we do silly things like build forts, but also get real, play a couple songs. You know, I was lucky to be living with my partner, Peter, who plays drums in the band, and we could do those things, you know, but I also deeply missed playing with people too. You know, that was a huge hole in my heart for 2020.
Yeah, okay. Let's hear some more music.
Awesome.
Thank you.
In my ear.
That was beautiful. Tell me about that song.
So the song Impossible Weight was, oddly enough, it's the name of the record that we put out, but oddly enough, the last song that we wrote. And I love when things happen that way, because we thought we had a finished record, and I think it still would have been great, but we asked, our managers were like, do you think we need one more song? And they're like, never hurts to try. So this little number popped out of a co-write, and I think it's like one of the most vulnerable songs of like me kind of playing tug of war with my younger self, all the disappointments that I experienced, and like, yeah, just being, you know, in a crazy industry that is the music business, but like also just telling my now self that it's gonna be okay, and like, you can let everyone down and you're still gonna be fine.
That record was the number one record for KXP.
On KXP, yeah, crazy.
Which is a big deal, yeah. Which is, I don't think anybody planned that.
No.
And a lot of artists, of course, planned on nothing as soon as COVID kind of kicked in. I'd love to learn a little bit about your mindset when this was happening, where you might have expected zero to suddenly have this. And then, you know, we're all used to living in a kind of way where like bad things happen, but they only happen for a little while. And then we're back to normal. Whereas normal, there is no normal. We're going through something right now to get there. You've got this record, which is an amazing record that you'd be going on tour with, but you can't really do that. But at the same time, the record suddenly becomes the number one record at the same time. So there's a lot of ups and downs,
yeah,
shall we say. And I'd love to know what your mindset was as you were ricocheting like that.
I think as a band and personally, I've kind of grown accustomed over the years to learning how to weather the peaks and valleys. And like, these are one of the most extreme ones of, you know, like I said earlier, a huge hole in my heart of not being able to play with other people and play live. And so that was definitely something I just had to get out of my mind and think of a new way to do it until we could get back to that. I think, you know, there's always like, oh wow, like the record got number one. Like, we did not expect that at all. And just, you know, every band is trying to get in front of as many people as possible. And so that was like such a gift. And also just like, oh man, I wish it could have happened in a year. We could have been touring, you know? Maybe it would have worked out better, but everything is hypothetical in the music business. And I think everything happens for a reason, so.
What were some of the things you did, if you can speak to the adjusting process you're speaking about?
I think the way that we adjusted over the last year is like, I think like many people, we worked on our mental health. And we held things loosely, and you know, it's easy to strangle up the process of making a record or hoping that it gets you X amount of steps forward, and it's never the way you think it's gonna be. And so this is just a blown up version of that. And so yeah, it was like a lot of time for self-reflection, and just, I think I was dreaming up ways of even how I could be a better person in my own musical community and how I could connect more with people. I connected so much, especially with other females in the music business over this time. And so it's a time of connection, and also just like even dreaming up of like, how can I contribute to, do I have anything to offer to speak into, how can venues like improve, you know, for artists' mental health when they come through town, all those kinds of things, and just getting conversations started. So it was an interesting time.
Were there any things that surprised you, how you approached this? Were there any things that you didn't expect, that suddenly you might be doing things differently, find a new skill set, or let go of stuff that you thought you had to hold on to?
I think we were surprised by how much we could do on our own. Peter learned how to like video edit during this process, and so we made like, and then I learned how to use Photoshop to a greater extent, and we did like a music video for, or lyric video for Lights Out, the first song we played. And I was able to basically like guitar tab out the solo in real time so people could actually visually see what it's doing. Just like little things like that where it's just like, oh, I didn't know I would be able to do that. And because it would be too hard to communicate to somebody at the time of like lockdown. You know what I'm saying? So we're like, well, let's just figure out how to do it on our own.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Perfect. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Let's hear some more.
All right.
Thank you. Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, let's talk about community for a little bit. We all have gone through quite a bit of changes in the last year. And one of the things that's come out of it is like, A, a lot more people are seeing therapists, and there aren't enough therapists out there. But the ones that have really suffered the most are the ones that didn't have community, didn't have anybody to rely on. How did community play in you with this the last year? Because it's interesting, you know, you're a performer. You're up on stage, you're putting it all out there. But every performer I know has like this duality.
Sure.
And how, knowing that you couldn't do that anymore, how did you reach out?
I think the way that we expanded intentionally with our community was just like I kind of touched on before, like being more present with the people that enjoy our music, like through our live streams and talking about real issues and you know, making space for the issues that were going on in our country that needed to be brought to the forefront too. The check-ins became more constant too with people that we knew who were struggling and vice versa.
Did it feel like you were part of a conversation instead of a lecture?
Well, I think that we were part of like the great leveler, which was at the time everyone was in the same position and no one was higher or lower. It's just like, okay, we're all, and I know it's been oversaid in this together, but we truly were at the beginning of no one knew what was going to happen. I think that's a humbling thing.
Did you learn things that you think you'll continue no matter what the future will be, or is this just like a moment for you?
I definitely think I learned things that I will continue on with. I know it's given me such a greater and deeper appreciation for the people that I've been playing music with, and just the act of being together and making music and playing live. I've always loved that, but I have a much more profound and deeper sense of gratitude for that now. And definitely in leaning out and like connecting with more people in the music industry, especially with other females, is really important to me. And
did you find that there is a need for that right now? Are more women going like, hey, we need to have a connection to each other?
Yeah, one of the things that I just got involved with is Moving the Needle, and it's a group of female or female identifying people who are artists, engineers, producers, mixers, and it's a conversation that is gaining so much steam of just like, you know, the facts are the facts. We're still very underrepresented in the studio. Just empowering like younger women and demystifying the process of all that is really important to me.
That's awesome. Mm-hmm. So this is going to be a hard one, and I apologize in front of you. Like, so the last time we talked, we had a different presidency. George Floyd was still alive. Me Too was just kind of beginning. We were aware of climate change, but we had an insane summer. As an artist, somebody who in one form or another has to like ingest this and then put it out, how has this whole process been for you as an artist? Like how are you coping, and B, are you inspired by all of the transitions? I keep going back like to the Clinton presidency. It was easy. It was so like, hey, everybody loved Americans. Now it's such a different place for artists.
Yes, it is a different place. I think like in the climate of this last year with all of its turmoil and issues being brought to the forefront, I think I felt very compelled to be involved and also compelled to listen to a greater extent to the voices that need to be heard and do what I do best, knowing that like music has its own healing powers as well. And you know, it might not sometimes be the best route for me personally and my giftings to just use my voice as a speaker, but to not neglect, just the act of writing music and the peaceful healing that can bring too, you know, when people need it. So I'm more aware of that as well.
Okay. You would see your audience on stage. They would be here.
Mm-hmm.
But now you're connecting with them using tech, using live stream, just knowing that they are gathering together and they all care about you, it's almost like this responsibility that you have right now. It was one thing when there were 1,000 people in the audience. It's another thing when you're actually spending time with them using tech right now.
Right.
How does that process work for you when you're now back on stage knowing that you had that connection. It's almost like playing for your family. It's like, how does that work now?
Well, I think that I'm excited for the hybrid of what is going to come of, yes, we have spent a lot of time connecting with the people that our fans are, our music. And, you know, just even seeing a lot of these familiar faces on the road now is going to be amazing. And I think embracing, you know, like live streaming has been a huge part of most of our lives in the last year and a half. And there's great value to that as well. And so I'm just excited to see what happens in the future of just like real, you know, in real time connection as well as what, tech can bring to the game too.
Perfect. Thank you.
Yeah, I feel like one thing that really helped in the process of like what is going to be interesting with touring now is like something like Bandcamp, the site, started having this one day every month where it would give artists 100% of the profits. And so you see a tech company that really took the reins of allowing or like kind of like driving forward this idea that we want to embrace artists in a time when they don't have the same platforms that they once did, but they're still doing well. And so you see a company like Bandcamp that allows us to like have such broader reach because their platform is enormous. And we would, you know, we mail out all our records ourselves. And so we see every single name that's on there. And so we see start connecting the dots on like social media with Instagram or Facebook or whatever, and say, hey, that person bought our record and one shirt, you know, and then we see what they look like, and then we might have an interaction with them, and then we might have an interaction with them in real life. And it's just everything is a lot more close and personal because of a step that Bandcamp took.
Okay.
And I felt that like that was interesting to me.
So that is that cool? Is that weird? Is that yay or?
I think it's cool. Like it can be weird, but I think for the most part it's really cool because it really like takes away that dividing line between you and your fans, like in a way that is good. And you know, we've made friendships with people over this last year that we've really connected with in ways that we wouldn't have if they just came to a show and we went to our green room, sold merch, played our show, did our thing. But because it was like this new normal where everyone was in this new state of relating to each other, like it became a moment where we could maintain and I guess, start and then maintain friendships with people that we wouldn't have.
They're making your music videos for you. I mean, it's a whole other relationship.
Unbelievable.
So it's also fascinating because we're gonna have to cut this out, but there are over 80,000 songs uploaded to Spotify every day, and less than 2% ever get played more than once.
Wow.
So how do you actually do this business? You know, how do you actually go where everybody with a laptop and a guitar is like, hey, I'm on Spotify, I'm a musician.
Yeah.
It's that connection that makes people go like, hey, I care about you, I'm gonna buy your merch, I'm gonna support you.
Yeah.
Which was, it's not an abstraction. It's like, this is real life.
Yeah. What was that process like, the ups and downs of, you know, the not being able to release a record as one normally would, then to a moment like the getting the KEXP number one? It took a reorienting of our expectations, you know, because I think releasing anything into the world, we live in a world where there's so much comparison and everything. You're looking at Instagram and seeing, you know, somebody else looks prettier than you, or is on a vacation that looks more idyllic than where you're at, or is eating a meal that looks really manicured and pretty. And so it makes you kind of feel bad. And the same thing happens in the music world where there's always a sense of like, oh, this person's doing better and they must be happier. The pandemic kind of leveled that and kind of made us all realize that we're in the same sort of boat. So it was kind of fun to see people like Janelle Monáe in real time totally messing up her Instagram live show by having the camera turn sideways, not vertical, so everything looked upside down. You know, and so it's fun to be like, hey, we learned that our first week of live streaming. And so that was fun. And then, you know, fast forward to something like the KEXP thing. We would never have expected that. But when that happened, it was just this, like Jessica said, this amazing gift that just kind of happened. And I think kind of was just like this little, not little. It was a massive reward for taking a risk of releasing an album in a time when a lot of people said, this is not the time to release an album because you're not going to be able to tour it. You're not going to do the majority of what it takes to release an album and promote it. And we said, this is all we know how to do. And this is the record that we have right now. And it just happens to, the themes connect with a lot of what people are going through. And so if there's ever been a right time, it's right now. And so, yeah, like to have that, it was just this gift that was given to us of, it was the right time and good job. And it was just like unexpected and glorious.
Perfect.
So that's all I got.
Thank you.
I would love to introduce the band. On bass, we have Yuki Matthews.
Splice in some clapping there.
Peter Manson on the drums. Elliot Jackson on the keys and guitar.
And last but not least, Patty King on percussion and vocals.
Killing it. This last song is called Stop Pretending, and it was written in the middle of the pandemic. And I am Jessica Dobson. That's my name.
Thank you.
Are live streams, virtual concerts, are they here to stay?
I think they present, that live streams present a different interaction than being there in person. But I think when I think back on discovering, you know, old clips that are put up on YouTube, I'm like, oh, I'm so grateful it was videotaped. Just to capture some of the magic, old Bill Withers, you know, recordings or James Brown or whatever it is. Like, I think there is absolutely a place for live streams and kind of capturing a moment in time for the future.
Will it be a like a hybrid of these things? Are you, it feels like we're at the beginning of something. You know, it's like, okay, how do we use technology? How do we go from here? You're a video editor. You guys run a social media company. You're a label. You're creating all these things that used to be done by others. Now you do yourselves. How does that, what's your relationship with technology right now? And do you feel that you can do it? Or is this just like a moment and you're like, I'm going to give this to somebody else in the future to do?
I think that our relationship with tech has been an empowering one in the last year, because more often than not, we now know how to use the things in front of our hands, and people are who are very gifted on the tech side of things are empowering artists by making it user-friendly and where we're able to go and make music videos on our own or whatever it is, you know, have better looking photos. I don't know. Sometimes there is a place and time for when you're like, I like what you do and I'm hiring on something. And sometimes you're just like, I have a vision and I'm going to learn how to do it myself. And so it's exciting when tech allows you to do that.
Is this something you would pass on to all other artists out there? Because I'm running into this, especially with older artists, they're like, I can't do it. And I'm like, you gotta do it. Or
regarding
you're just gonna
tech,
be left behind.
I would pass down the message to younger artists of do everything you can yourself, learn it on your own, especially when it comes to recording. And then you know, you learn your strengths and weaknesses and you learn how to stay in your lane and what to, you know, hire out on and trust other people who are gifted in those areas. But like, I think a lot of times artists when they're younger, they wait for someone else to do something, and that comes in many forms of like, I need a manager to go to the next step, or I need a booking agent. It's like, no, book your own shows and manage yourself until you find someone that loves what you do and comes on board naturally. Things like that.
Okay, mm-hmm. Perfect. Thank you.
You're very welcome. Goodbye, Chef. Thank you again so much for having us. We really enjoyed playing ChefConf, and hopefully we'll be able to see some of you guys on the road.
Very much greeting to you straight from Haiti. This is Lakou Mizik, and we are so happy to be part of the ChefConf this year. So we're gonna present our first song, and We are so happy to be with you. Lakou Mizik. This is Lakou Mizik again, straight from Haiti. We are very, very happy. And the next song that we're going to present to you is... Bye.
dégasse. Le monde me voyait pas, ouais, mais ça m'a pas allé. T'as fou mon bas pour ça et la joie t'a compliqué. Pas rien si le bien, mes amis c'est pété. Bah, je voulais se dégasse. Et pour le fouet, maman piqué. C'est lui qui voyait m'acheter. En vérité, pas grave, c'est vite. Et c'est lui qui t'a passé, c'est lui seul qui casse le poignet. Les amis, elle aimerait les souffler.
Normalement, pour COVID là, égal, nous-mêmes la musique en tant que musicien, et nous sommes obligés de faire poser. Nous sommes obligés de faire poser parce que nous gagnons seulement. Thank you, Steve. Merci en ville. Et nous, bon, connaît, nous sommes musiciens, c'est travail par nous. Automatiquement, nous pas qu'à faire spectacle. Et nous sommes obligés de poser. C'est normal. Et c'est un moment qui était vraiment difficile pour nous. Et pendant COVID, ça, nous avons obligé tout le monde de casse. Mais nous avons essayé de créer l'autre activité pour nous qui nous avons plus ou moins qu'un bébé. Parce que vous connaissez, il y a une petite, il y a une famille. et tout ça yo égal c'est musique nous fait c'est ça c'est à partir de ça que nous vont retomber égal et nous sommes obligés quand même créer l'autre activité et mais et nous gain à cause de réseaux sociaux OK des technologies alors et c'est si nous voulons nous essayer quand même faire quelques lives bah comme ça et gain en pile monde de quoi en Europe yo te mandé nous et live et Canada États-Unis d'autre côté ça yo égal et nous essayer quand même font kembe pour nous qui gens mais après ça en pile problème tremblement de terre vinn tomber et problème nous vinn empirer plus grave et les politiques président et politiciens qui pas aimer peuple et tout ça aussi c'est un peu le problème et actuellement Haïti n'a rencontré avec un phénomène gang kidnapping tout ça égal et qui vraiment
des bagarres
pays j'ai pas bon pour pays égal moi pense que bon de toute façon nous même la musique nous là n'a pas énergie hein, et message positif là et n'a continuer vendre culture ça que nous gagnons qui c'est pas nous et qui porte guérison pour le monde.
And our next song would be Anba Siklòn that would said that under the weather and basically said that when we have a natural disaster, natural catastrophe, people turn 4 to 8 just to have the benefit. So when they send the thing for the people that need it, and most of the time, people that received it, it's people that don't need it, and then people that need it don't have nothing. So the song basically said we turn 4 to 8 when under the weather, under the hurricane, we turn 4 to 8 and we turn 7 to 9.
Yes.
Trip nan problème mwen contribuer nan souffrance mwen gajon a trip nan misère mwen
pitié
gajon a trip nan problème mwen contribuer nan souffrance mwen gajon pilonne fierté mwen oh
pitié
Haïti gen pou changer ya wel pays sa gen pou marcher ya wel Haïti gen pou avancer ya wel mwen di leve men on di oui Haïti gen pou marcher ya wel pays sa gen pou avancer ya wel Haïti gen pou fleurir ya wel mwen di leve
Siklòn, eya, eya, pendant le mauvais temps, on y fait ta photo d'accord.
Siklòn, eya, eya, pendant le mauvais temps, on y fait 7 jours tous les mêmes cours. On a un petit clone. Hey ya, hey ya. On a un mauvais temps. Pour nous faire 4 jours tous les mêmes cours. C'est ça l'ivier pour étonner.
Conscience,
pas regarder. Haïtien nous y est là.
Conscience,
on nous mettait pour n'avancer. C'est ça besoin de vous.
Conscience,
pas tout par la dalle. Ou pas concerner, non pas dit ça.
Conscience,
yo 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 yo.
Conscience,
yo 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 yo.
Conscience,
yo 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 yo.
Conscience,
ouh la 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 la.
This is Under the Hurricane from Lakou Mizik. Thank you very much to have Lakou Mizik this year and ChefConf. We are very, very happy. And the next song will be when the conga is playing. They call it Tanbou, Frape. It's a song that says every time there is a conga playing somewhere, Haitian strength doubles. And every time we play the conga, we multiply by 10, though, actually. So that song is called Tambun Frappe.
Aïe bobo la kalakaye. Aïe bobo toi baguette toi légué. Aïe bobo la kalakaye. Aïe bobo toi baguette toi légué. Côté le passé le fait tout sans vibrer. En dans un trail nous l'y démêré. Côté le frappe le fait tout le monde danser. Avec nous te chante liberté. Toute nation est transformée. Sous tête orteil nous tape danser. Tant moun frappe, garçon pas campé, non. Tout le monde est connaissé, haïtien nous y est. Li aï bobo, hey. Tant moun frappe, force nous doubler. Maman, tant moun liberté. Frappe, force nous doubler. Toi, tambou, m'entend Ijaé. Tambou, frappe. Aïe, bobo, la kalakaye. La kaye, s'en va chanter.
Aïe, bobo, toi, baguette, toi, légué.
Toi, baguette, légué, délié.
Aïe, bobo, la kalakaye.
La kaye, s'en va m'attendre.
Aïe, bobo, toi,
l'esprit on t'apprend à l'interpeller. Dit des salines, manger des filets. N'ont pas besoin qu'on nationalité. Pas jour non, car fou force nous doubler. Nous tout compte qui est nous y est. Yon d'elle maman, papa liberté. Et puis ou poche, wap tout collé. Tendez, fais moins c'est. Parce que tambour frappe.
Aïbolo. Tambour frappé, fasse nous doubler.
Bon, oui, et dans mon président, il était vraiment bon, saccager le monde, pas seulement Haïti, parce que vous comprenez que mon président, so, si vous rentrez comme président, vous tuez, mais nous-mêmes, nous vivons la paix en tant que citoyen, et je pense que je ne peux pas parler de sécurité, parce que si vous rentrez comme président, que vous tuez la Cali, on est la Cali. Et c'est le premier citoyen pays. Hein. Et je pense que ça grave, c'est grave en pile. Et tout genre de problèmes, ça, yo fait y fait. Sous tout ça, nous avons fait comme progrès, comme des bagailles qui ont été dans le pays ou bien qui ont aidé, mettre les mains pour un pays avancer. Égal, c'est des bagailles, nous avons un paquet de problèmes qui sont sous nous.
C'est Jonas, c'est que. Soit dit à son exemple, ce n'est pas directement tuer le président seulement qui vraiment bagarre qui impossible. Parce que le temps président est là, tu as pile monde qui a mouru mal, chaque jour. Ça veut dire que le président a montré vraiment un désordre qui dépassait l'État, qui dépassait toute bagarre dans la vie quotidienne, toute bagarre dans la vie sociale. Non. Ça veut dire que quand on a fait une route, il est bloqué, on a monté là, on a dit. Et tel genre de tel bagage, tourner. Donc, tout bagage, ça depuis le président avant qu'il était tombé, que tu as gagné même les bagages. Et ça a montré que tellement des autres là, en pile, les puissants, c'est que même des autres là, arrivaient congolais, président. Tout. Ça, c'est un bagage fatal, vraiment. C'est pour montrer que vous n'avez pas de sécurité, pas de tout le monde supposé veiller quand vous mettez pied au. La coup musique. Veiller quand vous mettez pied.
À moi là.
Allons bas où déjà. levé bonheur, il voulait le planter. À 6 heures, on va le débarquer. Respite, il dit, bon, bah, on va le planter. À lui, il faut qu'on va le planter. Comme tout ça déjà. Maman Jésus. Papa m'sou kabani pour vous lever. Chantier à café nous est à préparer. Ouais, moi garder vous même pas sous tifé. Moi même ça. A midi, faut qu'on veille à jouer manger. Oui, la pauvre.
Yes, thank you. This is Lakou Mizik straight from Haiti. Yes, my friends.
Energy! Hallelujah! Samba ou pran pale nan la kwa, samba rele.
Samba ou pran pale nan la kwa.
Samba ou pran pale. Samba ou pran pale nan la kwa, samba rele.
Samba yo pran pale nan la kwa.
Samba yo pran pale
nan la kwa, samba rele. O sanjo, o sanjine, a tout on si a to wesan. Marasa dosu dosa, damble damble, jam jam, douvan, vodou, ki macha lada. Halada, a tout nan chon, ki ile.
Song called Gaya, and it said healing. So I think right now in Haiti and the world, we need that healing. We need that Gaya. We need to feel better. So that song called Gaya, I say feel better, feel Gaya, feel strong, feel back on your feet.
Oh, petit garçon.
Et j'en loue pas mal et posé mon petit garçon.
Je dis pas entrer dans le dossier, mon petit garçon.
Et j'en loue pas mal et posé mon petit garçon.
Je dis pas entrer dans la parole, mon petit garçon.
Et j'en loue pas mal et posé mon petit garçon.
Moi, sinon, pas gars qui déclare le pays, ça.
Gaya, gaya, gaya. Oh, 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 gaya, gaya.
C'est pas si il est de Salina.
Gaya, gaya, gaya. Oh, 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 gaya, gaya.
Oui, bien si l'équilibre est réel.
Gaya, gaya, gaya. Oh, 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 gaya, gaya.
Les gars qui te cassent, qui le disent ça.
Gaya, gaya, gaya. Oh, 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 gaya, gaya.
J'ai pas respect au bloc, c'est pas fou.
La roue ouvre chine. La roue ouvre chine, vous nous passez.
Moi j'ai dit Kafou n'a ouvre chine là. Kafou ouvre chine, vous nous rendez.
Ouvre chine. Kafou ouvre chine, vous nous passez.
Moi j'ai dit Kafou n'a ouvre chine là. Kafou ouvre chine, vous nous passez.
Kafou ouvre chine. Kafou ouvre chine, vous nous passez.
Right there we have Belonian the accordion, Zao in the conga, we have
to be see the king in the garage. We have James and the conga. In the back, we have Dave in the drum. And then we have Ronald in the bass, the almighty. This is Lakou Mizik straight to you from Haiti. And what you think, we sing something together, eh? Let's do this. We do like that.
ChefConf.
I'm well. Yeah.